All 10 seconds game plus. Starting off the ban here with Helgren as well as the Harith being removed.
I think they're doing the wave in the crowd.
Whoa.
Yeah, they're setting it up. They're trying to set up the wave.
I can hear them from right down below here.
All right.
Well, that's definitely one.
There it is. Okay, Respect. Where are you guys? You need to come down here and be a part of the community. But let's go into the game where the first pick is about to be selected for the side of 10 Seconds Gaming. Helcurt, Kimmy out of the picture. Exporting is going to be the pick. Todak, Rafaelia, and Harith are out of the picture.
We saw that Export coming in for 10 Seconds Gaming Plus yesterday, where they just went on that jungle raid, stole every single holding that they have on the table, and now Rock will be taken in for E1.
Very good opening coming in from Todak here. Grok, solid pick overall. Doesn't matter what comp you have a Grok, you have some form of control of wave clear and early game pressure. Masha here is where it gets really interesting. They're kind of telling you, okay, we have a split push component. What's going to be R4? We're going to let you decide. Kufra going to be the first pick. That means Gushin is not going to be exactly the best mage going into this, so they might want to pick up the Lunox for themselves this time around for 10 Second Gaming. Ooh,
wow.
Selena! I like the aggression. 50% win rate overall. It's a little risky, but you need a lot of mechanics to make it work.
And speaking of risk here, 10 Seconds Gaming Plus only takes calculated risk. And we've seen these Selena before, just about yesterday on that game 2 where they managed to secure so many kills with that Abyssal Arrow landing the shots pretty much perfectly. And my, I would say Todak definitely needs to look out for that. But Masha though, what do you feel about Masha as you see quite a lot of disruptive units heading in for the picks of 10 Seconds Gaming Plus? Can that Masha push effectively?
I think Masha should be able to push pretty decently. She just has to be very aware, because once you know the presence of Selena is in the map, you can kind of tell, okay, she's going to go for early rotation, she's looking for early kills. I need my team to kind of help me communicate where she is all the time. The only problem I feel right now is that Selena could be put into that support position, and then that kind of opens up, oh no, wait a minute, that means they could still go for the Lunox if they wanted to. So that's kind of the trade-off here, not to mention that Kaja is still on the table.
I definitely would agree with that in that sort of sense, where that's sort of like a flex pick right here for 10 Seconds Gaming Plus, because Kufra can still play support, that sort of a core tank in that sort of sense, and Selena, I would still prefer her going on that DPS threat in that sort of sense though, but Chang'er, is that sort of a pick where they're just going to be focusing on a whole lot of that team fighting style heading for Todak's side here, and Todak now is going for that Lolita ban just to negate that meteor shower from landing.
Yeah, I think getting rid of the counter pick is smart here. The only downside I see from this is the fact that, you know, Selena's on the table. There is no one to kind of just tank it with the Guardian's board to just not have to worry about it. Cho being the pick coming in from 10 Seconds Gaming here. Again, a lot of flicks, but we need to know who it is so we can kind of determine what the team composition lineup from 10 Seconds Gaming is. But so far, Chiku locking in that Granger, it's looking good.
Wow, looking well indeed. And that's going to be the Gato Kacha that we mentioned even before the draft even started, which means the side of 10 Seconds Gaming Plus does not have a marksman per se. Man, I'm not too sure what to feel about it, but there's enough DPS coming from Selena anyways.
Well, I mean, it's not like we haven't seen this before. Yesterday, they did the exact same thing against Axis Esports here. What's really interesting is that they have Selena to try and play that early game. They want to use Xmark as a replacement for the Marksman. He's going to be running around with the two tanks as a 1-3-1 composition with Selena sort of, you know, deviating and rotating between the lanes as much as they can. Now, coming into this, Todak, their last pick is going to be the Valir. And this is what's really scary. Yes, he is good. One Abyssal Arrow, he's gone.
Yeah, not only that, there's so many of all these units that can actually dock the backline. You got the Kufra, you got the Cho, got to Kacha for sure. And Export, we know Export to be great. And you can just easily dive with that figure out offering tech anyways. And
yep.
Selena always being a little bit more sneaky in her approach. So in terms of that draft that you just saw here, which one would you actually root for? Because for me, I look at Todak here, they got that solid new meta sort of style going on, and they got a whole lot of key picks, but so does 10 Seconds Gaming Plus.
I mean, I'm just scratching my head because, hear me out. It's a 1-4 composition for Todak, where the 4 is looking to kind of siege the opponent. They're using the Valir as well as the Chang'e to kind of push them off towers, look for those bigger objectives. But the problem is with the 1-3-1 composition coming in and from the side of 10 Second Gaming, that Kufra is going to be so huge. If he finds an engage or an Abyssal Arrow lands on one of the key targets, Chang'e, Valir, that could crumble. They have a great engage option to deal with this siege. So the question is, which one of the win conditions is going to come online first? And I think it's like a good 50-50 here.
Yep, and speaking of 50-50s here, for the fans, they're definitely ready for this game one to just unfold. But speaking of that sort of a point that you just made there, who's going to come up online first? I feel like Todak, their strength will only lie from mid-game onwards. Early game,
that's true.
Maybe it's really based on how the Grok's going to be setting the tempo up. But after that, they really got to make sure that they set it up. And now, of course, this will be the 10 players on the field getting ready. Blue side, we have 10 seconds game plus. Todak on the red. And let's talk about how they will pace themselves. You mentioned about that 1-3-1. And I think that to 10 seconds gaming as well as Todak, they faced that before. They're not unfamiliar with that. And now we're about to hit in towards that first game. Of course, just keeping you guys on your seat. So, as we are. So, get in. So, game one here is just going to be sending one of these teams here on that sort of a nail biter. But there's just so much to win and so much more to lose as we head towards this first game between Todak and 10 Seconds Game Plus.
Yeah, this is going to be a head scratcher here because, again, all of these teams want to be on top, but they also have a lot of elements that allow them to counter your opponents. These first 3 minutes for Todak are going to be so crucial.
They just got to make sure that they don't really give advantages to 10 Seconds Game Plus because they have been really disciplined. And if they actually slip up one little bit of that tiny room of a window, 10 Seconds Gaming Plus will be able to punish them. And speaking of a punish, flip the health bars left on top of E1 and X-Ray here, dealing blow for Obuyan pretty much early. Interesting to know that this Kufra has been holding on his soul lane for quite some time. Well, we see the Selena going in for some camp.
Yeah, they want to make sure they want to punish the top side of the map. Looks like Chang'e is kind of forced to wait this one out, but that means the top side with Chiku as well as Valir will be able to defend themselves if a dive is imminent. Level 4 is probably where they want to set that up, but the pressure that's going to be coming out of them is going to be tough.
Well, Chiku here have to give way. They know that if he stays under that tower, he will be taken down. 4 members through to try to secure the first tower in the game. But here comes E1 as well as Nenas. And Nenas getting knocked right over the wall. Flicker being popped there. And look at the damage over to Mimo. He walks away alive.
This is actually genius. I think Todak was setting up for this quite well. They defend the bottom side while 10 Seconds Gamer were looking to get an early tower. Todak, great defense coming in from the backside. Quick rotations. They gotta keep this up. Chang'e already popping in the Meteor Shell. They're pulling back. They need to get out of here. Suray is so low. X-Ray is in trouble. He flickers on out of there. But the winner coming in for X-Ray. 1 HP. He's alive. He's pulling backwards. They need to breathe. Nobody has died just yet. First blood is still on the table.
Close calculations, that could have been the blaze inside, giving away first, but to send 10 Seconds Gaming Plus. Now, going for a little bit more jungle raids, as this is the signature playstyle for 10 Seconds Gaming. Papa here, getting his first boots of the day, while Tataka, of course, will secure the first tower for 10 Seconds Gaming Plus, giving them a little bit of the lead, but Todak opting to actually equalize with that turtle attack.
Yeah, they need to make sure they break the Firaga armor from Papa. Oh, Garokacha coming in with Sky Guardian Avatar. He takes quite a bit of damage here. The backline, Papa's in trouble. But they gotta be careful. Obuya just getting ready in the brush to collapse on them. They're gonna try and punish Papa here.
Oh, speaking of a punishment, Shaku will be the guy who gets first blood in this series.
Finally, first blood has been broken, but look at the gold difference from both of these sides. 10 Seconds Gaming, at least 500 gold, 600 gold ahead, but that might slowly change if Todak is able to break that first turret.
Well, Todak is still looking to actually find a way to break down those objectives like you said, but Obuyan here, opting to actually get him out. So right here, whoa, big dive's coming from Tomibo. A little bit of distance though for Echo Fart to commit.
Yeah, it looks like Moon did take the flicker instead of the sprint. He does not want to get caught. Ooh, quite a bit of damage here, but they're not going to commit onto the Grok. They're just going to continue to the bottom side. Obuyan's in trouble. He takes vitamin damage. He's by himself. But that's Sonata. Chiku gets a nice kill with the turtle buff.
This is the first time I'm seeing mistakes coming out from the side of 10 Seconds Gaming Plus. And that was that server rotation where they don't really have any information by the corner of the river. As now, Kotaka walking to a trap. Wall charge won't be able to take him down for now.
Yeah, that's going to chunk him out. They're going to trade their bottom lane for the top side. Again, remember, 10 Seconds Gaming, despite them giving kills, they're still pretty even in terms of the gold, and they still haven't broken the top side.
Whoa, Flicker coming out from the Grok, and Obuya has already got himself a little bit of backup, so they will possibly hold on for this for a little longer as we look into some of all these spells here. We do have Arrival on Obuya. Usually we do see Flickers heading into here as a pick for a Kufra, but instead, this is something that's definitely different where they could easily go in for the teleportation to save other lanes.
Yeah, and I think right now the utility of the battle spells coming in from 10 Second Gaming is just so important here. X-Ray is going to get that first initial destruction. Obuyan, following like how that Filipino finals were happening out, trying to push the Siege Torrent away with the Wrath. X-Ray might be in trouble, forces out the Flicker. Top side is where the next fight is about there, but Sore falls down, revitalizes a little too late. Chiku with the Rondo goes forward, and he doesn't exactly get that last couple of hits to ensure the crit, but they should be able to secure a turtle.
I just love how the tempo is being set right here. And now Flicker has been popped by some people. Through the speech, there is nowhere to run. No escape whatsoever. One more kill, and it's towards the side of Todak. And wow, 3-0. This is so much of all these noise coming from the fans as they are performing out him up.
Oh, Chiku, one more kill. That turtle buff is just making him an absolute beast.
Whoa, 5. I was just talking about 3 kills out of nowhere. It has all stacked up. Now Todak here, 15k versus 30k.
Yeah.
As we'll see, one more fall. There it goes, counter into the supply. Finds the 4v1, outnumber, outlasted, but X-Ray has tanked it all.
Okay. I mean, look at how the map is being played. Tier 2 is being caught on the other side. It's 0-6, but again, they're even in turrets. And finally, Todak have developed a lead for themselves. It's been a while, but now Todak might actually be able to start ramping up into this game.
Yeah, and this is where things get a little bit out of control. But 10 Seconds Gaming Plus, I do believe that they could stall this out for a little bit longer.
Oh.
And eventually, Papa might get those right items in, as he still doesn't have that sort of tankiness to actually front the battle. And look at the gold graph here, slowly sliding in towards the side of Todak. And now, 3k goalie, you can close it out with one good fight.
Yeah, and Minas just bought his Ice Queen's wand as well, so if 10 Seconds Gaming are looking for those big engages, Obuyan needs to land it on top of both Chiku as well as Linas to make it 100% effective, or maybe even Moon if he gets lucky.
Yeah, and now I'm not too sure how lucky could they really get though when you're facing off the best of Japan. And Totaka here, one versus one, won't change it. Chiku is so nasty! He didn't need any help!
Somebody clip that! That was absolutely insane! Both sides playing at the top of their game there, but Chiku survives with 1 HP thanks to the invulnerability of the Death Sonata every single shot!
And that was a critical pull right there! I wouldn't have thought. I thought it takes 2-4 auto attacks coming from the Granger, but one shot was all it takes. And of course, that's what they get here. 10 Seconds Gaming Plus already losing all too much. And Sure here overcommitting to that fight. That's not going to be able to actually do all too much. The shower has been utilized by Moon. But now, Todak will be pushing in from all directions except for the bottom lane.
Yeah, and right now, Nanas, he's playing in the back line. Every single time they go for an initial engage, he's just peeling off the tanks like, hey, we don't want you to get overwhelmed. We have like a little bit of a barrier, a little bit of a circle of safety that you need to be in. As long as they stay in range and Nanas does his job, he will find another one. He might actually get it. Oh, Tomebo is actually going out of here. Papa in the back line, Chico's in trouble. He goes down after the last insanity, peeled him up. Sure is taking quite a bit of damage, but Nanas, he's on the opposite side. He needs to be with his team to protect them. He's doing a lot of damage to Obuya, but it's not going to be enough. As they walk away, it's going to be a 1-for-nothing trade.
I just like how 10 Seconds Gaming Plus, they do know what's the max ranges heading in towards the opponent's side. As we saw, they were actually trying to commit inside of the jungle. They did take down Chiku though, but they almost had Tomibo getting clipped out, and he had to flicker at the sort of max range as well.
Yeah.
And if he did not flicker, he would have died right here, right then.
Exactly. And now, see, that's the thing. The Nas has to be aware. He's trying to keep away the priority target, which is Obria. But in situations like that, he kind of needs to peel back with the team, kind of slowly keep the distance, maintain it, but still deal enough damage to kind of splash it across. So if he's not efficient with his spells, that might net them the loss later on into the game.
Efficiency is definitely of utmost importance. Lands. E1, the only one alive right in the middle. But E1 survives with the wall charge. He hits right outside. And X-Ray here turns it around, tries to get one kill up. There's immortality as well. So he will go in to revive himself. And now, First Lord already appearing.
Wait, Chiku on the bottom side. He's trying to get rid of this inhibitor. They're looking along. They're all recalling. They have to take this out. Masha, she's going to be running all their way. She can solo this Lord, but she has backup just in case. They pull a lot of pressure. Two people have gone to the bottom side to take care of Chiku here, but Lord is now in the hands of Tora.
Two versus one over the bottom side, which means that Tensex Game Plus might have to give out away this First Lord as they go on a reset once more. Chiku only being brought down to 40%, but Tataka already getting shredded to pieces by only a Grok. They don't really need to actually overcommit this, and they understood all too much. Chiku still on the push, so Tataka can get either one of these objectives.
Looks like Chiku just get initially taunted, but he has to back away. But now Lord is in the hands of Tataka. There's nothing they can do. They get a kill onto the Joe, but on opposite side of the map, Selena did get the initial kill onto Chiku. This is going to be A-OK. They just need to push slowly. First Lord of the game, up the day for Tataka here. 3-11 score. Tataka are in the lead. They need to make this count.
I'm not too sure right now what 10 seconds gaming plus could possibly do, because they're pretty much under level at this point in time, and Chiku is that beast that's standing right before their eyes, and they could not even get anywhere close to actually finish them off without stacking at least two units or three.
I think argument. Oh no, Papa, the Piranha armor is being broke. Obria needs to block. They need to reset right now. They need to reset because 10 seconds gaming will be able to respond to the waves. They've cleared top, they've cleared middle. Now it's just the Lord. Tataka, they want to slow this down to allow Chiku to get there quicker. But 10 seconds gaming, they need to cut off rotation paths and split quickly as possible. Destroy that Lord. E1. Every single time he is slowing down this wave. This is genius.
This is definitely a stroke of genius instead of luck. And here comes the Lord hitting out the bottom side here. Moon trying to suppress them with a little bit of that chunk of damage getting out. And here comes E1 crashing right in as the Krupa is the first one to fall. And there it goes, Papa here defending me alive. X-Ray tries to flicker out, but that will be a great catch coming from Tataka. And now E1 getting surrounded. And there's only going to be Moon trying to send him out with a mirror shower. And it's too little too late. Four members taken down from the side of Tataka. And 10 seconds game plus. Hang on for dear life.
It was a risky 50-50 there, but 10 seconds gaming managed to come up on top. The Abyssal Arrow onto Chiku, stopping him getting the second and third shots of the Death Sonata, made it actually a huge difference there because of a lot of the damage comes from both Moon as well as Chiku.
Yep, and looking at that fight, how they actually initiated, was really hard to actually follow up to begin with. Let's have a look into the instant replay brought to you by Evilbound. Look at that go. Like, they were in between and torn apart, split into two, and there's nothing much that Moon can even do because she's so far away.
Yep, and look at Tomibo. Like, the thing is, he finds these angles, he gets chunked out, the last insanity just clipped at the very edge. I mean, Tora have to be so much more careful here when they play out their fights. They got a little too greedy to get that inhibitor. Yes, they did get it. However, they lost so many members, and now they have to wait for the second Lord. This is their last window to end the game before 10 seconds start catching up.
Well, we're already seeing them close up a little bit of that sort of the goal lead that they had. It was more than 10k difference, but here comes Tataka here, getting shredded for a little bit more, but Tataka does not have to worry all too much because there is his allies backing him up.
Yet, Yeah, agree. I definitely agree. But like, give it two more seconds, he would have died there. Masha is an absolute beast right now. Chiku just bought the Berserker's Fury. 10 seconds gaming, they're 7-8k behind, actually. And that's what's scary, because you're seeing like carries like Chiku picking up their big boy items, their final items to really set them apart from 10 second gaming. They need to land their damage. If they get caught by an Abyssal Arrow or a Last Insanity, or maybe even Totaka in the back line and get one shot, it's over.
We've already seen Tomibo pulling up a lot of turnarounds and clutch moments throughout the entirety of the tournament. And now it's that late game where Selena, for some may say, it may not be as expected heading in towards early to mid game. But once those items are up, they're still pretty much lethal. And wow, Wood coming up with that meteor shower has already expended this. But Ward coming up within 22 seconds right here. They might just have to pick up this fight. As we see, the wall has been brought up.
Chiku. Chiku's in trouble. The backline is dead. Oh wait, they actually turned it around. They actually turned it around. Chiku's alive. And now they're going to continue the fight. They might actually win this. Tona is already in front of them. They get two. They've got their initial kill. Two kills again. They're going to break Obuyan's spirit. Break his immortality. And now they're looking to end this game.
They are tearing down the Japanese side, and we saw them splitting the half the map. That was a little bit way too much to actually handle for the Japanese team. And wow, they also went to chase that Moon, and they could not even get anywhere close to that. Papa now trying to actually keep to that members right here as X-Ray is soloing Deathlord. And here comes Papa popping out the Last Insanity. Sirius is going to be charging at the back. They know that this is a lost cause. But the wall, the Great Barrier has been brought up. Immortality being bought there by Tang'er, and they have lost yet another lore.
Oh my goodness, I can feel the ground shaking as the crowd is getting ready for the end game here. Todak 10k ahead. 10 second gaming. I mean, they're getting their final few items, but this 50-50 is going to be everything as Ward is going to be walking up to that crystal.
Now, look at those items. I'm just fixating my eyes on Chiku because this guy here is possibly going to complete his very final item already in a span of 15 minutes.
Yeah, Rose Gold Meteor. He needs to ensure he doesn't die. I'm surprised he didn't go for something like Immortality, but he's like, no. I just need a shield. I can outplay them. I don't need the safety of an immortality.
Yeah, he's definitely a little bit more bold. Yep, Chiku, as we speak of him, gets that Rose Gold Meteor. And to that, have no other objective than to escort the Lord to finish off the game. Maybe break down the mid lane if they may, but 10 seconds to game plus. They need to get prepared for this. One Abyssal Arrow lands onto the unit with Immortality. It doesn't really mean too much, but there's just so many safety net for Todak as they have already gotten all the sort of lead that they get. And here comes
Surai. Surai, he's in trouble. Obuyan gets to the backline. Moon is in trouble. He quickly uses the ice. Windsor Trudger, they're making their way forward. Nenas, he's peeling them up. And Lord is in trouble. They lose mid turret. Chiku sees the opportunity. Masha in the top side. He breaks it all the way through. He wants to get to the crystal. The Death Sonata chucking out to Mabel. They get a mega kill. They're walking in to win this game. Todak take game one.